Yeah, thank you so much for coming, and I'm grateful and honored to be here. I kind of would like to change it a bit, because normally, like when I'm invited for a talk, then I have a specific topic. They want you to talk about allies, working with refugees, or causes of migration. And when Heidi contacted me, she was like, you can talk about what you want. So I sat and I was, what do I want to talk about? And it was growing and growing and growing. So I thought, yes, it's a good opportunity to have this platform which you're offering to talk and have people listen. Because that is one of the big topics for us as migrants, as people who have arrived here. And even after living here for like several years, sometimes we have a feeling we haven't yet arrived, because we still don't have a voice, you know. So this will be an evening, I called it on easy listening, because unlike other talks, there will be no questions afterwards, because I think that disrupts this process. There's a difference between hearing and listening. We can listen with the ears and without really listening with our whole body and our whole self. The kind of listening like which I'm inviting you to do is listening is a process which could be sometimes you listen and you get what is said in a second. And sometimes when you listen, it might take 10 years to really understand what was said. And this is why there won't be any questions and answers. I would really just like you to be here, to connect, to feel, to listen with your whole body, with your memory. Because often, like, people listen and they ask for a talk and they have no connection to what is said with their personal lives. So I was invited to talk about post-colonialism, and I asked the students, these were all activist students, all studying, all very theoretical, and when I asked, why does this interest you? What has this got to do with you or with your biography? And nobody could say anything. So I think if we really want to change things in the world, it has to be very personal. You cannot separate the political from the personal. And this is why listening is really an intensive experience. And you listen also with your memories. You listen with the memories of your ancestors or with your grandfathers and remember, oh yes, my father said this to me. There is a connection. And this is important, I think, when we think of terrorism, war, conflict. There cannot be any solution without communication. And the basis of communication is always listening to each other, listening to the sufferings of others, listening to their experiences, listening, understanding their hopes, understanding their desires, understanding where they're coming from. This, I think, is the first step. And today, I will just share like different experiences, which some personal experiences, some experiences of our group collaboration as it is. And like you mentioned, Schwarzenberg Ballet, this is also like an alliance. People ask often like, what can we do, what can we do? And in the alliance with Schwarzenberg Ballet, I would say it's like the kind of micro world of everything, which is because what we are trying to change is a system. And this system has been in place now for over 500 years. And just demonstrating or just talking is never going to change a system which is so deeply rooted. And it starts with each of us and really connecting and really being personally involved. So all of us are activists, and yeah, I would start now. The first part is mainly I would just talk a bit, show a few clips, and later we prepared some songs, like which we Some of them are on the CD. And yeah, so you can come forward. Maybe it feels more intimate than all the empty chairs in front. And you can start.
Yes, please.
Oh, but I forgot to say the title. I just asked again.
Okay.
The title was Performance Protest Politics.
Exactly.
Okay. So.
In about April 2015, when four boats capsized in the Mediterranean with over 2,000 people, this was like when people started, oh, what is happening? We have to do something. And I started about this time hearing of the refugee crisis. Refugees are coming. And but the thing is like, this deathscape at the borders of Europe, people trying to come here, going through the Mediterranean, it's not a new thing. It's been there since the 1990s, but nobody was talking. This was how they started with the frontiers and building borders. So actually, it's not a new thing. It's been there for years. This is like from my point of view, this is not a refugee crisis or a migrant crisis. This is part of a struggle, you know, a struggle between nation states, between capitalism, and between humans who are struggling for their freedom of movement. This is actually what it's about, and it hasn't started 2015 or recently. It's really a long process. It's the struggle of human beings. We've migrated all the time, and if you look at the history of slavery and colonialism, it's always been the same. The politics will try to separate and try to say these are the real refugees who are fleeing from war, and other people who are fleeing from the global inequality, fleeing from poverty because their sustenance has been destroyed by the West overfishing, or by unjust economic terms, are suddenly criminalized and made to be illegal. It is never illegal to seek a better life, you know. And unfortunately, we have never really tried to reflect and honestly written history in the books. So like for me personally, when I was in Africa and in 1994, when I decided to come here after the war started to look like it would really develop into something bigger, I decided to come back to Germany from Sierra Leone. I had been here in 86 as an exchange student, and I thought, okay, I would come back. It was interesting for me to see the totally difference in the realities, you know, a different reality, the experience you have coming as a middle class exchange student, living maybe with a German family, and the same experience you have when you come here seeking refuge, for example, was totally two extremes. At the time I came, I was lucky to have, because I spoke German, I was lucky to meet a woman at the German embassy who was very sympathetic to my case and was like, okay, I'll give you a tourist visa so you can leave right away. And unknown to me, like having a tourist visa is contradictory to being a refugee. So I spent the first years in Germany, maybe 5 years, really in a up and down with the authorities of why are you here and what is this, and others who came could easily pass through. So these are some of the different experiences, and I could never really understand between the people who I met every day, who were always very, very friendly and spoke English and were happy to meet you, and the experience you had when you went to the Ausländer Behörde, Biber House and all these places. I couldn't sleep for months knowing, oh, I have to go in 2 months, was like, ugh. And there was just this big contradiction, and I was like, but what is wrong? How come everybody I meet is friendly and helpful, and but why is it when I go there, it's a totally different experience? And friends who I spoke to were always shocked. Oh no, of course it's not a problem for you to stay here. You just need to, no, it's a problem. They were also so unaware of what was happening. So it was in later when I started to realize something is wrong, and I just passed it on. In the meantime, I did my best. I did my best to integrate as well as possible, learn the language, and study and get to work. And up to a certain point, it worked out fine. Eventually, when my first daughter had horrible problems in getting in, allowing to stay here, because at that time the immigration policy regarded children under 12, over 12, as adults. And she also came with a tourist visa. We could extend for a certain point. And after a while, when she was 12, it was like, yeah, she can go back. She has no right to stay here. And we had this whole big war with the authorities trying to have it changed, and got lawyers and spent so much money. It didn't work out. Later we were advised, okay, just go, it's too much trouble, just have her go there and you can apply for a visa and she's back in the next weeks, which we did. And she went back and we applied, and the weeks turned into months, into years, into really devastating time. So eventually she did manage to come back. We did manage to bring her back, but you cannot regain all those lost years, you know. It's very hard to, you can't make up for all this time. My activism for me then started when I started working with migrants, with African migrants, in an initiative called Akonda. And this was maybe 10 years later, 15 years later. And they started to tell me their personal stories or ask for advice on certain issues. And I realized nothing has changed. They had the same problems trying to unify with their families, trying to have their children stay. And I was really so devastated. Because, like I said, the experience I was having in my real life, in my daily interaction, was totally different. And I was really shocked to see 15 years and nothing has changed. Then you really have to do something. Yeah. So about 2013, I started to have also some students who were coming from Italy, and they explained to me the situation after the war in Libya. Later on, they had started to organize, they were increasing. I would walk and see in Harbor, young African man, and say, are you looking for, are you lost, are you okay? And he says, yeah, no, I don't have anywhere to stay. And where are you from? I'm from Ghana, I'm I just came from Italy, and eventually they had got a place to stay at Picas, and which is like a homeless institute.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out that when the winter was over, they were all just turned out onto the street. And this is when they started to organize themselves. And for me, I was really very, very touched, impressed, happy to see that people who totally have no voice, no stay here, could have this courage to say we have rights and we want to stand for them. And I looked at myself and my past, and I said, well, maybe I've been too, you know, all the years here. And you say, okay, yes, we were active. We had organized a lot of things in Akonda, and in also in other contexts, little demonstrations and done what we can. But I think we also were very careful. We were always very careful not to be, we were always very careful to be obedient in our activism. And this form of civil disobedience was really something which I think deserved respect. And that was what happened. It did catch the attention of several people, and several people were also started to become more aware of what is going on and show more interest. So that was actually, so when we talk of Arivati, I would say without the group Lampedusa in Hamburg, there probably wouldn't have been any Arivati, because the courage to do something and to be a little bit non-conformist, non-authoritarian, I would say, came from this group. So I have here with the group Lampedusa in Hamburg. Just a short note. With the group Lampedusa in Hamburg, we had organized like a lot of demonstrations, sometimes as large as 30,000 people were on the streets demanding that they get their right to stay. The main demand of the group was to have their recognized status as refugees in Italy converted here. Their situation was that in Italy, the Italian government had, when the funds ran out, there were certain funds which were granted to the displaced people and refugees from Libya. And after the funds ran out, all the refugees were sent out of the camps, and some were given some money, many were not, And they were asked, they were given travel documents and asked to move on to other European countries to, yeah, to settle. And yeah, so they arriving here, they had started to organize themselves. They had gone to the Rathaus and demanded to speak with the mayor. And yeah, the movement started to develop. So this is like the first visible movement, pro-migrant, pro-refugee movement in Hamburg, I would say. But despite all the mass demonstrations and negotiations which we had with the government, there was still no budge, because the willingness, the political willingness, was just not there. And then the strategy further developed, and it was in this particular clip was another act of civil disobedience to have a sit-in in front of the parliament. So this is what this is.
My solution, that's domestic. I'm not too diverse like that, you know. We are not yet to do violence or any other thing.
Is it loud enough? Yes.
What did you do? You are a criminal. See what you did for me. You are a criminal. You are a criminal.
This particular action was very interesting because before that there had been a good collaboration between the supporters or the Solidarity Alliance, I would say. And at this point, the camp started to divide because some felt this is too drastic. So for us was also the question of the solidarity, where exactly it starts. Germany is very proud at the moment to be like one of the countries with the welcome culture, and they kind of decorate themselves with that, the welcome culture. What exactly is that? The demands of the refugee movement have been basically three: the right to work, no deportation, stopping the mass accommodation, and also the main one also was the restriction on residence rate, which is now gone. All these laws have gotten worse when you look back. The immigration laws and policies have gotten worse with time. And even while the welcome culture was like being celebrated, the laws and the politics were being tightened and being very restrictive. So in a way, the welcome culture was also working against such actions, because for people who went into the civil disobedience, they had been living on the streets for 2 years. In Italy, if some even more, many have children and were forced to live on the streets with no assistance whatsoever. And this was for them like a desperate action, because it was about their personal life, it was about survival. It wasn't just an action. At some point, the demonstration started to look like a carnival, you know, with activist groups or supporter groups being very creative about what they wanted to do, but somewhere it lost the focus, or it didn't really center on the realities and the desires and of the people who were really involved. And this was one of the points of reflection at some point, like to realize that that solidarity is not about you experiencing compassion. So for some it was all about them and their compassionate feelings and their platform to offer empathy and their platform to do. But it was it lost the touch of really focusing on those who were really impacted. And this is one of the reasons why in such movements and struggles, those impacted have to be in the forefront of the movement, of the actions. It's very important also for us to learn to take leadership. I mean, we have been ruling more or less. The first world, so-called first world, has been doing and ruling, and we're not very happy with the results. And I think that people also felt this urge to show compassion. It shows something, some essence is missing. And for many people, this was like an outlet. So definitely, I think there is a majority which wants change. Being an artist myself, I was interested when Schwabingrad Ballet approached us in the coordination and asked if we would be interested in an art activist collaboration. And we've been working together, I think, about 3 years now, or no, four years also. And the process has been very intensive, because we do discuss intensively. We have a lot of, which are not always, how would I say, it's not always comfortable. And this is something I think which is part of the communication process. I mean, it's not very easy to collaborate when there's so much difference in the power structures. One group has money, one group has doesn't have to worry about their residence, you know. Some people have networks and are well established. And at the end of the day, when the with many of these projects, I spoke to a lot of people and they said, I've been in so many projects. I've talked with so many people who want to write their thesis and this and that, and at the end of the day, I am still here, I don't have nothing, and they have gone, you know, even if there's no material gain, there's a symbolical gain. And with our collaboration, we set it as a goal to fight against that, to see that really we really discuss on things and fight if necessary, not physically, till we get an agreement. But in the collaboration, there is no hierarchy of the West, I would say. For us, it's very important also to bring in new perspectives, and also against Eurocentric world views and things like that. A lot is taken for granted in my schools in Sierra Leone. I also went to school in Nigeria. When I look back at what I was learning in school, I would say it's no wonder that the state of many African countries is the way it is, because I was still learning that Columbus discovered this. I was still learning that missionaries brought civilization. So many things which just are not true. You open the books and you see the school books which the little children have in the kindergarten are books which are outdated here, which have been discarded since 30 years, and they are shipped to Africa and the little kids grow up watching that. And just as the colonialists, when they left, and the whole emphasis was on growth, not on redistribution of the wealth which was, you know, the same way these colonial legacies continue to today. If you walk in Africa, in many states, there's a church mosque, and the traditional religions are regarded by some as evil, and whereas they don't even know what the religion is themselves, because it hasn't been taught or passed down. So, this is some of the things like which we talk about in the group, and many of the songs are also about our discussions about these perspectives. Like Ire Ire is also one which talks about honoring ourselves for what we are. So I have here also like a small clip. In 2000, was it 16 or 15? Beyond Welcome. 15. 2015, we developed a series of. 16. We developed a series of interventions, which we called Beyond Welcome. The first one was in a refugee camp. In the refugee camp. We had discussions about that. Several of us didn't feel good about performing in a camp because one of the demands is abolishing mass accommodation. At the same time, it was a possibility to really bring the protest into an unusual space. So with this collaboration, Shravigrad, Balet, and Arivati, we also work with spaces. And in that intervention, we tried to go into the camp and take over the space, and maybe also as an encouragement to the others there, like even if you have no choice of being outside somewhere else, you can still be empowered. Then we also had an intervention in the rat house, where we had gone in there and had a series of podium discussions about the Africa and Europe debate and discourse. We had in Schnelsen, we were also in a family camp there and tried to organize tents and have discussions with the women also. There's a special situation with women refugees who have been totally, as always, neglected, totally invisible in the struggle. A lot of focus is always on the men, and the women have specific cases because those with children, for example, are not as mobile as the men. And this was also an attempt to go in there and to discuss with them and to build alliances and make connections. And it was also very, very powerful. The men also took part in it. And we invited them to the last intervention, which was at the Stadtpark, where we invited several refugee groups. We picked them up with a bus and brought them there. At the same time, we invited also other migrant groups and members of the German society. It was also a neutral setting. It was about discovering things together and just connecting on a, we tried to create a neutral platform. One of the women we had invited to help organize it has been in Hamburg organizing the International Women's Festival. And she had said, like, there was so much to discover in Stadtpark that even Germans don't know there's so much to discover. So we thought, okay, let's use that. It's a nice setting. It's a natural setting. You don't need any money to go there. You can simply just go. It's open to everybody. And yes, we invited everybody there with the children and. Yeah, it was nice.
So this is the Beyond Welcome series. Thank you.
the defense, the camera, the heat detection line.
Traffickers, and this wouldn't be necessary if they could just travel with an airplane, which is much cheaper and much safer. But Europe has constantly building borders and installing a lot of instruments like Frontex, and always a lot of money are being given out just to protect Europe. So Bodies Will Be Back is like dedicated also to those who lost their lives in the Mediterranean crossing, in gratitude of those who survived this journey, and yeah. There will be a time when bodies will be back. be a time when we will cross the Mediterranean, decolonize cities, because this is the place of our desires, and we will never leave. There will be a time when bodies will be back. We will cross the streets among the hookers and the rubbers we meet. This is the place of our desires, and we will never leave.
Thank you.
Barnett, out of all our numerous discussions. And Ted Geyer put it for me in a German text. And this song is about when we talk of communication, then we talk of language. Language as an agreement people have as to what certain things mean. So this is a song about language and how we use it also, the language of exclusion, of excluding others. Okay.
It is one in German.
Den guten Willen, nicht den Abrede stellen wollen. Um es mal so zu sagen, es nervt. Der gute Wille nervt. Der verständnisvolle Tonfall, die Sprache des verständnisvollen Nicht-Verstehen-Wollens nervt. Das Richtig-Machen-Wollens, des steifes Grinsens, des eifrigen Nickens und die bemühten Gestures täuscht nicht hinweg über die Grenze, die Ecke, der Zaun. Ja, ja, no borders, aber in der Sprache jede Menge borders. Boring borders, boring. Since ages, since ages, since ages. Die Sprache, die Sprachlos macht, die uns zu unseresgleichen und euch zu euresgleichen gemacht hat und mit jedem Satz uns zwangsläufig zu dem anderen gemacht hat. Die Sprache eines Sprachers, die dann aber andernorts von großen gemeinsamen Wir spricht. Einem Wir, was ungefragt eingemeindet. Your brothers and sisters. Und alles, damit ihr euch in eurer moralischen Überlegenheit als etwas Besseres spüren könnt. Since ages, since ages. Eure Projections, Protagonisten in eure Schlachtengemälde. Solange wir das Maul nicht aufmachen und euch enttäuschen mit falschen Vorwürfen und Undankbarkeit, wir das pur menschliche Mitte-Besierte. Solange wir das Maul nicht richtig aufmachen, so richtig, richtig aufmachen, als Dekoration gelegentlich in eure Runde gesetzt, ganz gelegentlich und dann aber gern gesehen, wohlwollend beglänzt, eifrig benickt, nur ungenügend eingeweiht in eure rätselhafte Spielregel.
Since I pray for balance
just an even flow between us.
Yeah.